Do. Make sure everything comes up. The sound works all right. I changed a bunch of stuff, a bunch of settings. There's the little skip. Looks good. Let me mute that so you don't get an echo. Facing limpers 35 to 60 big blinds.
Now let's discuss when you are facing limpers as stacks start to get a little bit shallower. In general though, the same logic is going to apply when you are deeper stacked because you're usually still going to be getting the adequate implied odds with a 35 to 60 big blind stack, and we're about to show you some examples of this. As in all scenarios, what is the limper's range, right? Is the initial limper tricky? Are they straightforward? Realize, some players will actually stop limping altogether as stacks get shallower. A lot of players think they're supposed to be loose and splashy when they're deep stacked, but as stacks get a little bit shallower, they start being a little bit more conservative and they start raising or folding every hand in their range. So some people will be very loose and splashy when they are deep stacked as a limper, but as they get shallower, they either stop limping or perhaps they become a tricky limper. So definitely be aware that a player's limping strategy when very deep stacked does not necessarily apply to when they are shallow. You're also going to want to avoid spots where you have to raise, or where you could potentially raise a decently strong hand, but then have to fold it if you get 3-bet or shoved all in on, because that's not desirable, right? Say someone limps, someone calls, you raise with a hand like pocket tens, and then one of the limpers shoves all in on you for 40 big blinds. It's a pretty bad spot and you probably need to fold, but you don't really want to fold a hand as good as pocket tens. So I'm not going to say you shouldn't raise it, but if you do think you're against a tricky limper, you should be way more inclined to not raise in that scenario. When you're facing multiple limpers, again, you always want to ask, how tricky is the first limper, right? You should typically play a little bit tighter than you normally would, unless you know all the limpers are very, very weak. Because, like I said, again, a lot of players do start to limp just stronger hands in general as they get shallower because they become a little bit more conservative with their stack. You may find that if you are trying to raise limpers as a bluff, raising to a large amount could be pretty sweet. Let's say it goes limp, 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 and you have king three offsuit on the button. It's a hand you certainly cannot play for its value, but it has a king blocker, right? It has a little something going for it. So in that scenario, maybe you want to make it 10 big blinds out of your 40 big blind stack. You're going to find that almost no one calls when you make it 10 big blinds out of your 40 big blind stack, assuming you assessed your opponent's limping strategy to be generally weak. So they're just all going to fold. You win the pot and you move on. And that's fantastic. You may say, aren't I very easy to read if I make it 10 big blinds with only my bluffs? Well, the answer is yes. The thing is, though, is that if you're playing poker tournaments, very often you're not playing against the same players on a regular basis. And you can get away with these plays. They will work very, very frequently as long as you do not overuse them. So realize bluffing is still viable. Another scenario you may have to worry about is when a bunch of people limp, you limp behind, and then someone raises. When that happens, you always want to ask yourself, what are my pot odds and implied odds? And you're going to find that sometimes you're going to have to fold as you start to get shallower and shallower because you're going to lack the required implied odds. Remember, you want to be getting at least 20 to 1 with the suited connectors and suited aces, and quite often you just will not be getting that. So if you're out of position and you're not getting the right implied odds, and you think the person who's raising the limper probably has something reasonable, you just have to fold. I know you don't want to fold hands like 7-6 suited, but very often it just is the right play. You will find that some players will actively attack limpers. Again, just thinking that they must have all weak ranges. And if you're against someone like that, mix in some traps. I have made a lot of money throughout my career by just flat calling limpers or flat calling raises with aces and kings because I can just look and tell the player to my left is going to be 3-betting a ton. So make sure you actively pay attention to that. Let's take a look at a few hand examples. Here we have a tricky player limping, another player limps, another player limps, and we have ace-jack offsuit in the cutoff seat. I think you have two options, right? You can either limp or you can raise. Typically, I am still going to use the big offsuit hands as bluffs because they have very, very good blockers. Even if you know the initial limper is going to be tricky, if you have an ace in your hand, it makes it way less likely that I have a hand like aces or ace-king, which is going to result in them not having the absolute top of their tricky limping range too often. So I like raising here, and if you do raise here and you get jammed on, you can easily fold, right? If you do raise and a tricky player re-raises you, they probably just have aces or kings or queens or ace-king, all of which dominates ace-jack, and that lets you fold. You're going to get very, very clear information. If I had a hand like a pair or a suited connector or a suited ace here, though, I would definitely just limp. I would not play hands like jack-10 offsuit or queen-jack offsuit. I would probably just fold those. If I did play them, I guess I'd limp them, but I would definitely not advocate playing the offsuit connected cards, even if they are rather high. If I had ace-10 offsuit, I'd probably 3-bet. If I had ace-9 offsuit, I'd probably just fold against a tricky limper and start using it as a bluff against straightforward limpers.
And the interesting thing is that when he said that, you know, when you make it 10 big blinds out of your 40 big blind stack, you're very rarely going to get played with unless somebody's literally playing a trap. That's the point of raising bigger. So in this scenario, you know, the standard ways would be 6, 8, 10, 12, 13, right? That's a pot size bet. That now means that you've made it 6.5 out of your 40 big blind stack. It's not as leveraging, but if you were to make this 2,000 out of your 40 big blind stack, you know, meaning you have 6,000 behind, you're essentially saying to the table, I'll go right now. You're saying to the table, I have a hand I will go with right now. So typically what'll happen is that'll make all these little limping hands fold. Now, if somebody's a tricky limper, yes, they're going to jam on you, then you're just going to fold. And you're going to sit there, and this is where you see players in a live game look over at the tricky limper, think about it for a while, flash them an ace, and then fold their hand. And then you see the tricky limper flash their aces, you know. And, you know, because people like to, you know, keep things cordial in a live game. But that's the idea of leveraging your whole stack, where you're like, you're making a big announcement that you're very willing to get all the money in right now. But that's considering what happens. So, like, if you had queens here, right, and it was limp, 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 and you made it 2,000 to go, and the player on the button jammed all in, and everybody else folded. Well, you're obviously not folding to that, right? Obviously, that's an ideal scenario where you have this extra money in the pot. A great majority of the time, the worst hand you're going to, or the best hand you're going to be up against is going to be ace-king. Believe it or not, you're going to see ace-queen a lot there. But you're going to see a ton of jacks and tens because players are going to think you just have the overcards. It's going to be super rare that you're going to be up against the aces and kings because of the limping behind, there's removal. You know, suited aces are going to get removed. Hands like king jack, you know, king queen suited are going to get removed. So it's going to be far less likely you're up against ace king or aces or kings. It's going to be more likely you're up against a hand that you can absolutely race against safely, you know, being ace queen or ace king, or you're just going to have them crushed when they roll over jacks or tens. It's actually very common with jacks or tens here. I've seen it a million times. But when you make it 2,000 here and then everybody folds and it goes back to the tricky limper, this guy over here, and he jams all in, well, now you can sit there and go, my queens suck. And you can just throw it away because of what's happened here. He's not doing that with pocket nines. It's just absolutely not happening. You know what I'm saying? Because the raise is so large, you're saying, my whole stack, let's go. And then he said, yes, the whole stack, let's go. So it's a good thing to be aware of that when you get jammed on behind when making that move, you know, with your good hands, you have to realize how awesomely in shape you are. Because I've seen players fold there and it's just a disaster.
So anyway, we do make the standard re-raise size. Remember, 3 times the last bet plus any additional money in the pot. 3 times 200 is 600 plus an additional 7 is 1,300. And we do get jammed on, which is fine. Realize this scenario. I'm going to be re-raising with aces, kings, queens, jacks, ace-king, and then a few bluffs like ace-jack offsuit, king-queen offsuit, ace-10 offsuit, king-jack offsuit. And we're going to be decently well protected because when I have aces, kings, or queens, I'm just going to call it off here. And ace king, and whenever I have one of the bluffs, I'm going to fold. If you think your opponent is especially tricky, you may not want to raise hands like queens and jacks. I think it's perfectly fine just to limp behind with those. You may say, but then you see a multi-way pot. That's okay. It's okay to have the best hand going to a multi-way pot, knowing that when you do flop poorly, you just get out of the way. You put in almost no money. It's okay to lose pots, even when you start off with the best hand, especially when you do flop poorly. But this is a very common spot where you raise the limpers with strong blockers. often they're just going to fold and you're going to win the pot. When you get jammed on, it's fine. When one player calls, you get to play the flop in position after the flop, and that's fine as well. We have another situation against a straightforward limper. If I had the big cards here, I would definitely raise, like I said. But small pairs, suited connectors, suited aces, almost always want to just call and see the flop. So that's definitely what I will do in this scenario. If I had a hand like Jack 10 offsuit now, I'd be way more inclined to raise with it, because now I'm essentially using it as a blocker bluff as well. I know a Jack and a 10 are not the best blockers in the world, but they still have a little bit of value. And also, I'm not necessarily raising because my hand is great. I'm raising because my opponents are going to fold too often. If I did have a hand like King 3 offsuit here, this is a pretty good spot to use that big raise play. Make it something like 1800 in this scenario. It's going to go fold very, very frequently. I'm not going to say you need to do it every time, but if you get the vibe that the opponents are especially weak and they're just going to fold to big raises, blast them, right? But in this spot, I'm basically always going to call with something like pocket eights and lower, and something like 10-9 suited and lower. Probably Jack 10 suited, I'll call too. Queen Jack suited, I'll probably call. King Queen suited, King Jack suited, I'll start raising for value. King 10 suited, I'll raise as well. So anyway, small blind calls, big blind now makes it 1500, and they fold back to me. Take a second, think about what you would do.
So this is a math problem. So it costs you 1300 to call. You need to be getting 10 to 1. You don't have enough chips to do it right there. That's the answer. You don't even have to do all the math. You can go, well, there's 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 23, 25 in the pot. It cost me 1300 to call. I'm getting 1.5 to 1. You don't have enough chips. You need to have at least at 13 to 1. You need to have 13,000 chips to have 10 to 1. So you don't have it. So therefore, this is not a hand you can limp with,
in this
or
scenario,
you can call with, because you don't have the proper implied odds. You could jam. Now, this is the big blind, right? Versus a regular straightforward player, honestly, in a lot of scenarios here, I'm going to jam. And they're going to know I have a pair. They don't know how strong or weak the pair is, but most of the time, this is just going to be hands like King Queen, King Jack, Ace Jack, you know, even Ace 10, things like that. And when they get jammed on now for the 9,000, they're going to be sitting there going, ah, fuck, this didn't work out. You know what I'm saying? Because they were basically playing a limped squeeze where everybody limped, and now they're like, nobody's making an aggressive action. I'm in the big blind. I'll make an aggressive action.
Well, now we have to put in 1,300 to a pot that's going to go to about 4,000. So that's about 2.5 to 1 implied odds. Plus, we can get another, we'll call it 6 to 1 implied odds from our opponent's stack. So we're getting 2.5 to 1 plus 6 to 1. That is 8 to 1 implied odds. Is that 10 to 1? No, it's not. And given it's not 10 to 1, we have to fold this. And you must be disciplined and make the fold. Ask yourself instead, what if the other limper's called? Take a second, think about it. Well, now instead of getting 8 to 1, we'd be getting a call here, a call here, and a call here, which would give us 11 to 1. Getting 11 to 1, we certainly can justify calling because that is more than 10 to 1. If we had a suited connector here, marginal suited ace, we would definitely fold in this scenario. If I did have a hand like ace 10 suited or a hand like pocket eights or nines, I think those hands are going to be good enough to call just because they are strong enough hands. But in most scenarios here with the hands that are obviously drawing hands, you are just going to want to fold and move on. So make sure you're actively paying attention to implied odds, because that is going to be very, very important whenever you're facing limpers and someone raises, or when you raise and someone three bets. And that's going to apply even more so as we get shallower and shallower. Really though, when you're playing with a stack depth, it's very similar to when you're deep stacked, so don't overthink this scenario. Just keep playing good, fundamentally sound poker and adjust to take advantage of whatever your opponents do incorrectly.
See, that's the thing. I was just thinking, where's your line for back jamming, right? Like, is it pocket nines? Is it pocket tens? What hands do you limp here that when this guy raises and it folds back to you, do you jam now based on the assumed range of the big blind? Which is a good thought to have. It's good that my brain is, you know, working in that manner now, just automatically behind the scenes while I'm sitting here listening. But I think I missed the larger point with that thought, which is that we still have a big stack. We don't need to take this risk. So maybe the only way that the back jam comes in is with real premiums. Like, maybe you thought this was a tricky limper, right? and maybe this guy had been done some wacky stuff or something, you know, maybe say one of those situations. So you have jacks or queens here. And maybe this is one of those ones where you're like, well, I have the position, I have, you know, whatever. Ace queen suited, I could see doing that. You know, that kind of hand. And I think maybe that's the line where when you get raised from the big blind, which to a large portion of the time is going to be a squeeze with no raise already in the pot, and it comes back to you, then obviously ace queen suited, you can jam jacks, queens, you can jam. But I think because of the depth of our stack, winning this 2,700 chip pot is not as a great upswing as the risk of losing all our chips. Like, sometimes you want to put it all in and you're like, well, if I lose all my chips, I lose all my chips. But if I double up here, I'm in a real position to do well in the tournament. That's true. But this is still very early in this tournament. It doesn't really mean that much. So you're going to get, I mean, the blinds are, you know, 1 and 200 or 2 and 400. You're 1 and 200. I was looking at the big blind ante as 200. You're going to get called wider. So like when you backjam here, the player in the big blind may realize, oh wait, this is a guy with a pair. So I have king queen, and when he has a pair, he doesn't have kings or queens or aces, so let's race. And you might just get called and just like now be taking this flip that you don't need to take. So I think that's the thing. I think having 30 blinds here, I think it's much different, because you definitely could have called this player raise, what goes back to you, and then you can jam. But I think at 44 or 45 blinds, yeah, you just have too many. Which is why we're talking about it at this blind level. So, an interesting thought that I had, but I'm going to have to do a little more work on it to make a definitive answer. But I think it's, you know, like everything in poker, it kind of depends. All right, let's try the quiz. Straightforward limper with 45 big blinds from the cutoff. He limps, obviously. You have ace-jack on the button. You should. You raise. And let's see. He's in the cutoff, so that's his one plus your one. Yeah, it's 4 1/4. Yeah. I just did his one plus your one plus blinds and antes, which is 2.5 for the blinds and antes. Your call is 1, 3.5. His limp is 1. That's 4.5. You just make it 4.5 or so. A little less because you're on the button is fine. Tricky player, 40 big blinds, limps the cutoff. You have 5-5 on the button. That's a call all day, my man, because you want to flop the set. And if you don't, you get out of the way. Tricky limper in the cutoff. You have ace-queen suited on the button. I feel like you can still call it. I mean, you're on the button, right? You have the positional advantage. Your hand's super strong. And plus, if it was offsuit, I could see raising it, because the hand's not as intrinsically good, but because of the suited nature of it, yeah, let's just call. Wrong. Is it because the range is so strong? A tricky player limps out of the 40 big blind stack and the cutoff. You have ace queen on the button. I mean, I guess it's because you don't want the blinds and antes to come in, and the hand is so intrinsically strong. All right, that's fine. Although you can see it's not too far off. Like, it was 75% of people answered to raise, or Pio Solver said to raise, and then I said to call. Nobody said to fold, no program says to fold. So it's not as black and white. There are some instances, 1 in 4 instances, where you're going to call here, but I guess we go with the majority. Cool. Let's go on to the next section.
Now let's discuss when someone raises before you, when you're playing with a medium stack between 35 and 60 big blinds. As always, what is your opponent's raising range? Very, very important. If they're going to be really tight, you should proceed tightly. If they're going to be playing maniacally, well, then you want to be proceeding with a wider range, right? Also, you want to ask, how likely are you going to get 3-bet by someone yet to act if you call? It does you no good to call the hand like 9-8 suited if someone is just going to 3-bet behind you and cut off your implied odds. Because remember, with this stack size, if someone raises, let's say, 2.5 big blinds, you call, then someone re-raises to 10, and you only started with 40, well, now you have to put in 7.5 big blinds into a, let's call it 25-ish big blind pot, which is 3-to-1 implied odds, but you're only getting another 6 or 7 or 8 based on the stack sizes, which gives you about 10-to-1 implied odds, but that is nowhere near the 20-to-1 implied odds you need. So you do not want to be calling too often unless you expect to rarely get 3-bet. How many people do you expect to see the flop? If you think you're going to see a very multi-way pot, you definitely want to have an implied odds hand. If you think you're going to see the pot heads up, or see the flop heads up, you are going to want to have a hand that just has good, strong, high card value, like ace, jack, offsuit. So you definitely want to be aware of the tendencies of the players yet to act. You also want to ask how the initial raiser will respond to aggression. If he's just going to call if you 3-bet very frequently, or rarely 4-bet you all in, you can 3-bet way more often than the game theory optimal charts will recommend. Because if you don't get 4-bet very often, it lets you realize your equity with your hand, meaning you just get to, you know, you get to see the flop and you get to the river some portion of the time, which is very valuable, especially when you have a hand that is behind or a hand that, you know, has some equity that would have to otherwise fold if you got 4-bet. So as you're going to get 4-bet less often, you should be 3-betting more often. All right, so when you're facing an early position raise 40 big blinds deep, you should typically assume your opponent has a decently strong range, because most people just only raise strong hands from early position. So you're going to need to bluff a little bit less than the charts I'm about to show you recommend. Also, if you 3-bet and they 4-bet you, they probably have an effective nut hand, and you really should be folding out all of your bluffs and maybe even some of the bottom of your value 3-betting range. Also, if your opponent limps some portion of hands, realize that their raising range could still be very strong, right? They may, let's say, play 25% of hands from early position, but they may limp 20% of them and raise the top 5%, which makes their raising range very, very strong when they have it. So definitely be aware of that. So against an early position raise in this scenario, you'll see this is actually similar enough to when we were playing deeper stacked. But in general, you're going to want to 3-bet the best hands plus a few blocker bluffs. In this scenario, under the gun, plus one versus under the gun, you see you're 3-betting Jackson better and Ace-King suited for value. You're 3-betting Ace-Queen offsuit, King-Queen offsuit, King-10 suited, Ace-9 suited, and King-5 suited as a bluff. Then you're just calling with the absolute best hands that flop very, very well. As you are in later position, you get to call a little bit wider, right? Notice button versus under the gun, you actually get to call very, very wide. And I would not quite recommend that you play this wide. I think this is probably a little bit too wide because, like I said, initial raisers from early position probably have very, very strong ranges. So I would fold out stuff like King-6 suited, King-5 suited, King-4 suited.
There was a webinar that Jonathan Little did where he said, well, why do you have these charts in here if you always say things like, I think in-game you're going to want to play a little bit tighter than this, then why show the charts? Because these are the charts that have been solved for the position of button versus under the gun, raise first in. And you're solving those based on the button's proper, or versus the under the gun's proper range. Now, obviously, if the under the gun has an improper range, this range changes. You know, if their under the gun range is only aces and kings, then this range changes to be much tighter. If this range includes everything because this person doesn't care about position, then this obviously gets wider. But this is the actual perfect solve. In-game, it plays differently, obviously. So that's why the charts are there, that he's saying, don't play this tight, play tighter. Or, you know, a little tighter, whatever he said.
And I'd be 3-betting more hands like King-8 suited, King-7 suited. But I do think you can still justify flat calling, like, all these suited connectors, small pairs. I'd probably use King-Jack offsuit as a bluff or a fold. I probably would not flat call that against most players, but I think all these other hands are pretty good to flat call with. It's pretty nice. Small blind and big blind, you'll see you're generally 3-betting slightly more linearly because you're going to get called some more often because you're out of position for the most part. And this all looks pretty reasonable to me. You may notice the big blind calling range is still pretty wide, but not absurdly wide, and that's just because you are against a strong early position range. Interesting that King 6 offsuit elects to call, whereas A 6 offsuit does not. You're going to find that these implementable game theory optimal charts are a little bit funny sometimes, but that's what they recommend. Again, I would just fold Ace 6 offsuit, and I'd probably fold Ace 5 and Ace 4 offsuit too against most early position raisers because they are just going to have very, very strong hands. Against the middle position raiser, you see a lot of the same trends. You get to play a little bit looser, though. across the board, you still see pretty polarized three betting strategies from the in position player. If you're going to be out of position, it's a bit more linearly. From the big blind, you get to call a little bit more often now because you are facing a weaker, wider range. Again, all these charts are available at pokercoaching.com, so make sure you download those. Do not think you have to memorize all of these, but you should reference them while you're playing until you generally know what they say. So facing a later position raise, this is where you can start to get out of line a little bit, especially if your opponents are a little bit too aggressive, or if your opponents will not 4-bet very often, or if they'll fold to 3-bets a lot, because you'll find that most players typically raise a little bit too wide from the later positions, which makes it harder for them to defend their ranges. All right. Button versus cutoff. This is, again, one of those very, very standard, stereotypical charts where you're just 3-betting a very strong linear range. Not much to see here. Small blind versus cutoff, though, you are starting to get pretty wide with 3-bets. I think a lot of people don't 3-bet nearly as enough in this situation. Something some people do is they'll 3-bet every hand in their range. I actually think that's a bit of a mistake. That's usually a strategy you want to be using when you are playing in a cash game where you're playing deeper stacked and when you're playing with a rake involved. There is no rake in tournaments once you pay the entry fee. So this is a situation where you can have a flat calling range, usually with the hands that just flop very well. I would probably not flat call king, queen 10 offsuit in most scenarios, or king 6 suited, king 5 suited. But, you know, it's reasonable. It's acceptable. Big blind versus cutoff. Now you see your calling range is very, very wide. Now, this is where the charts start to change as we get shallower and shallower stacked. We start to see an all-in range. So notice small blind versus the button. The button should have a pretty wide raising range, which allows the player in the small blind or the big blind to shove some portion of the time. You're typically going to find the small blind shoves more often than the big blind. That's because from the small blind, you still have to worry about the big blind calling if you flat call. So you'll find that the hands that usually like to shove are hands like ace queen or ace jack offsuit, hands like middle pairs, and hands like suited aces or random blocker hands that have decent equity, usually the suited ones. And as you see, that does hold true in both of these scenarios. And you may say, if someone raises to 2.25 big blinds, am I really supposed to be ripping it all in for 40? And the answer is yes. And that's because these hands have lots of equity, but they're out of position. And when you're out of position, you tend to under-realize your equity. And these hands are all pretty good. They are going to be in decent shape when they get called, which means that when you do get called, it's not like you're losing a huge amount of money. And you're going to have a ton of fold equity. And we're going to see as we get shallower and shallower, you get to jam all in even more often. To the point that once we get really shallow, you don't even have a 3-bet small range, or 3-bet non-all-in. Notice that, again, the 3-bets are with bluffs are usually the blockers. You do see some suited connectors 3-betting, though. Notice for the big blind, it really prefers stuff like ace-x offsuit, king-x offsuit, and queen-x offsuit as bluffs, which is pretty neat. And that's just because you're closing the action, and you really don't want to screw up a hand like jack-nine suited by taking it and 3-betting it, because you can just very, very profitably call. Playing from the small blind, I do want to really address these two specific scenarios from the small blind and the big blind. They are very, very important. You play pretty similarly to when you were 75 big blinds deep. You're going to find that you do still 3-bet a decent amount of the time because playing three ways with the worst relative position should be avoided unless your hand is pretty strong. You should be 3-betting more often when the big blind plays well. If the big blind plays poorly, you get to call more often. If the initial raiser will reply in a timid manner, you should probably 3-bet more often, right? If you're not going to get 4-bet very often, you should 3-bet frequently. And you want to be 3-betting more often in general if your opponent's going to just be raising a wide range that's difficult to defend. Getting the pot heads up or reducing the stack-to-pot ratio is highly, highly, highly beneficial. From the big blind, again, pretty similar to when we were playing deeper, you want to aim to see lots of flops, especially against wide ranges, which is why you get to flat call very, very frequently. You also want to defend wider as your opponent uses a smaller raise size. You'll find that some players min-raise every hand they play, no matter the stack depth. And if that's the case, you should actually defend a little bit wider than our charts recommend, because they presume a slightly bigger raise size. If your opponents use a big raise size, like to 4 big blinds, you should be defending much tighter. You may notice that we're already kind of, like against early position, we're already defending pretty tightly. If your opponent uses a bigger raise size, you should defend even tighter. Let's go back to these charts. I'll show you. In this scenario, when you are in the big blind against an under the gun raise, like all of these offsuit hands, like 5-4, 6-5, 7-6, 8-6, 8-7, 10-8, jack 9, queen 9, king 8, ace 7, all these should just be folded along with the rest of the very bad suited connectors. I'm sorry, the very bad suited hands, like 7-2 suited and 8-3 suited. All those should be folded whenever you are playing against a bigger than normal raise size. Let's discuss blind versus blind play.
This is where you should live. The blind versus blind, 40 big blinds deep. You're seeing another one of these very complicated small blind charts. This is where you should live. Everybody loses in the small blind, especially, but everybody loses in the blinds. Getting this stuff down and reducing the amount you lose versus the field wins tournaments. Like, it's, if you said if you could have one winning position, what would you want it to be? I would say small blind every time, because it's just so much value. But we'll see.
Very quickly, again, these charts are very convoluted for the small blind, but you do see this pattern that we observe when we're deeper stacked still applies. In this scenario, we're raising and then calling off. Raising and then calling the re-raise with our best hands that flop very, very well. We're raising and 4-bet jamming with these hands that have loads of equity plus a few bluffs with pocket fours and ace five suited. We're raising and then folding these, you know, marginal hands that are not good enough to call a re-raise. Then we're limping and then jamming all in over a raise with hands ace-queen, ace-jack, pocket sevens, pocket threes, and pocket twos. This is very similar to the all-in strategy when someone raises and you just jam 40 big blinds. That's also what we're doing here. If we limp and someone raises to 3.5 big blinds, we're just jamming 40 with a rather similar range, right? Remember, ace-queen and ace-jack offsuit. Turns out those just like to rip it all in. We're limping and then re-raising. Ace-10, ace-king suited, ace-10 suited, tens and nines, and king-5 offsuit, right? We have some very strong value hands that we're not folding, and then we have the king-5 offsuit as the bluff. We are limping and then calling all these hands that flop very well in pink. And we're limping and then folding all these pretty trashy hands. That all makes sense. It's very difficult to memorize again, so make sure you look at this chart, you observe the chart, you reference the chart while you're playing, and that's going to make applying this much easier in game. Big blind versus small blind limp. You're raising the best hands for value, plus these suited connectors that flop very well that usually fall below your opponent's calling range. Remember, take a look at this. The limp and then call range is all of these like bigger cards, right? These hands down here actually fall in this area, meaning you're not going to be dominated all that often. And then you're just raising some total bluffs. And big blind versus small blind raise, you are very, very polarized. Re-raising just the absolute best hands and some very, very bad hands. And you're going to find that that's usually going to be the strategy against a small blind raise in general, because when the small blind raises, they typically have a pretty strong range. And against a pretty strong range, you really just can't be 3-bet bluffing all that often. So you see a few slight changes compared to the deeper stack charts as we get down to the 40 big blind charts, but not a ton. As we get a little bit shallower, though, which I'm about to show you in the next section where we discuss playing even shallower stacked, you're going to start seeing significant changes where you are going all in more often instead of 3-betting small, and that's going to be neat. A lot of people think that they're supposed to do everything in their power to conserve their tournament life and not go broke, but whenever you start getting shallower and shallower stacked, or when you're late positioned against another late position player, and you get something decent, you're just all in, and that's going to result in you busting some portion of the time. But that's okay, because these plays are all profitable, and if you make profitable plays on, well, a regular basis all the time, the money will flow your direction in the long term.
All right. Under the gun plus one raises 2.5 out of 45 big blinds. Everyone folds to you in the big blind with 9-6 off. Well, let's just go to the charts. Let's just straight go to the charts. With the tools. Here we go. What do we say? We're at 40 blinds, let's say. What was the position? Big blind, 9-6 off. Position. We're in the big blind versus a raise from, what was it, under the gun plus one? Yeah. Opponent's position under the gun plus one, 9-6 off. It's a fold, baby. I mean, you should be defending wider out of the big blind, but this is just a fold 100% of the time just by the charts, so that's what I'm going to go with. Yeah. Too weak. Low jack, 2.5. Everyone folds. The big blind, you have 4-7 suited. Well, I mean, that's kind of easy, but let's look it up. Low jack, 4-7 suited. Ta-da, callie call. It's easy to defend because you're in the big blind and you don't have to put in too much and your implied odds are really good, so nice. Low jack, 2.5 out of 40. Everyone folds to you in the 10-8 suited in the cutoff. I think it's a fold. Low jack raises to 2.5. In the low jack, right? You're in the cutoff. Everyone being one player in between you. I think it's a fold, but let's look it up. So I'm in the cutoff in this scenario versus a low jack raise. 10-8 suited. Oh, that's a call. Did I say call or did I say fold? It's a call though. Yeah. All right. Hijack 2.5. Everyone folds to you in the small blind with jack 10 suited. That's kind of tough because we have the implied odds, the 20-1. I think we call here. I'm just going to go with it. I'm not going to look it up. Wrong. Okay, fine. You're three betting. Great hand to three bet from the small blind. Hand has good playability. Will perform well in three bet pots. All right, let's double check it. Let's see here. It was small blind versus hijack. Hijack. Oh, duh, small blind ranges. Oh, I'm an idiot. Yeah, I'm not even really awake, so obviously. See, but it says 10-jack suited is a call. He has 50 blinds, though. Let's go to 60. That's a 3-bet at 60. Okay, so you can see at 60, it's a 3-bet. And at 40, it's a call. So I guess it's 50-50. And when something's 50-50... because he's at 50 blinds, like we don't have that for the chart. When something's 50-50, I do like to err on the side of aggression. So, yeah, 3-bet is the move. Cool. Button raises 2.5 out of his 40. Everyone folds to the small blind with queen 8 suited. I think that's a similar scenario, but you might actually be able to call it now because of the lack of removal. 2.5, 40, button versus small blind. Oh, this is a jam. This is a jam, I think. Yeah, I had to read it twice. Small blind versus button, queen 8 suited. Where is it? It's a call, huh? See, I feel like that's, well, oh, okay, so the all-ins come with queen 10 suited, queen jack suited as the semi-value bluffy ones. And then the middle pairs, and then the pure bluffs of ace 5 and ace 7. Okay, I see. Okay, so it's a call. All right. All right. Interesting. I guess the hand just doesn't have enough intrinsic value on its own. I guess having good removal with the queen jack and the queen 10 that are suited for the 40 big blind jam then makes it an all in. All right, that's cool. Let's see. I'm gonna mark this as complete.
Now let's discuss when you were facing.
And I'm going to go back to the courses. I want to make sure that it marked everything off. I'm a little, I'm not tired, but my brain's just kind of not all the way awake yet. Okay. So we got through that. I think two sections is good for today. What I am going to do, though, because it is a play day, so I don't want to be on too early this morning. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to play the next Jedi Mind Trick right now. Before I go off, because I'm actually really proud of it. It was a lot of hard work. It's on YouTube, and I just want to get it seen. I don't even give a shit about the views. I did already view it last night on Twitch, so it's up there, but I'm going to go ahead and play it right at the end of this, and I'll see you guys later today when I come back. Probably going to be playing around 2:30, maybe 2 o'clock, but yeah. So that's what we're doing. So I'll see you later. Enjoy the Jedi mind trick. If I can do this right, I gotta switch scenes.
just going to make a bet that I think he can call with top pair. Sixes? Man! We got some optimists in the audience. Woo! I thought he would call me with nine. With a nine, like 9-8 or something or whatever, but sixes? Woo!
It's better to get called on the bigger bet than the smaller bet. Makes it worth it for all the times we don't get called. It's kind of like if you're going to go fishing and not catch anything anyway, you might as well fish for a marlin, you know? If I'm not going to catch a fish, I'm going to not catch a big fish.
This isn't like the other guy. This is an obvious fold, by the way. Yeah, kings and queens. Yeah. No five, no seven. Fuck you. Bastard.
Lean on it, but we can definitely play our position. We see a three bet out of a comparable stack. I don't think we fold for this price because we can flop the nuts. And when you know you can flop the nuts, you just call, right? Because how can they beat you? And, you know, he's going to bet big here probably. He may even bet standard. Maybe he's a good player. But he doesn't know our plan was to flop the nuts the whole time. He bets big. I'm going to let the time run and then see what he does. I think raising here is kind of pointless. He's betting more than a third, but less than half. So I think he might have something that he likes. The king, the only bad part is it kills our action if he has jacks. But he's going to have ace, king, king, queen a lot. If he checks, we're obviously just checking back. But he's probably going to jam here about 60% of the time. We're going to go ahead and quick check. Hopefully no ace comes off. Cool. He may jam the river. If he doesn't, we can make a bad bluff sizing that he'll pay off. So, but we have the mortal nuts. I think that was a character on He-Man. He bets, and he bets pretty small. I think he wants to get called here. But obviously I'm going to raise with the nuts. I'm just going to overbet jam it. And I expect to get snap called quite often. I don't expect him to fold ever. He did. He had aces. Good for you, bro. Well played, I guess. But you didn't know we were going to flop the nuts. You know, small blind matters. That's the new human rights movement. Small blind matters. I can make that joke because my wife's a small blind. That's a thinking man's asinine statement right there.
Oh, I hate you.
It's kind of not a great flop for kings. He checks quickly. I'm going to check back. This player flops all boards, so I'm not even really afraid of the ace yet. He bets. I'm just going to call. If he bets small in the river, I am going to raise, I think. He goes ahead and checks. I think we try to get thin value here. A little less than half pot. How you like that? Call me with fourth pair. How you like that? How you like that shit? Oh, it's such a good value bet. Oh, it's a weird hand to have right now. If this player raises, I think I just jam. Same thing for this one. It sucks, but I kind of have to. Like, I can't set mine versus a guy with 13 and a half big blinds. And I don't want this player to come in cheaply. So sometimes we run into it behind, but I don't think we can call here. We definitely can't 3-bet. Oh, look at this shit. Oh, come on, baby. Don't do this to me. Really, the one guy who's got me covered? Hold. 7. Look at this shit. No chop. Don't put a 6 out there. I didn't care about the aces, man, but I just didn't want to lose to the ace king.
But it's not impossible. Ace to bullseye womp rats in my T16 back home. They're not much bigger than team meters.
I'm just going to min raise because this guy's going to be all in 100% of the time. He's going to reopen the betting. So hopefully some big stack calls and this guy jams and then I get to re-jam. Getting better to 3-1 with my jacks. Well, it doesn't matter. This guy jams. Really? This guy just calls? Well, I'm not. He could have aces here sometimes, but obviously I'm just getting the money in. Kings. Jack. Clubs? Ooh. Clubs. Club, 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 club. Woo! So 18 is the next pay jump. You'll see for 1575, then it goes 15, 12, and then the final table. I'm just going to go ahead and bet, and I'm going to bet pretty big. This isn't a kill pot attempt. I'm trying to look like I'm bluffing. I don't think I fold. When he calls, it's kind of worse because he's drawing at a horrible price, which means my hand is vulnerable. Three on the turn. He could have a three for sure. I do think we keep betting, though. I mean, if he has pocket tens, it's just too bad, but he could have 8-7. If he has a 3, it's just too bad, but he could have ace 8. I don't think we're folding to this guy at this point. If he beat me on the turn, fine. Let's see it, bro. Yeah. It's just never going to work,
right?
This is what
this player does when I limp.
Like, never going to work.
I'm not convinced I have the best hand, but I'm figuring it out. I'm just going to check. He could have a random diamond, and I don't think he folds. I mean, the guy's got 80 fucking blinds. The size of his bet will kind of tell me. The over bet? Ugh, it's the nuts or nothing. Nothing. What's more likely? Exactly the king of diamonds with an over bet? Or no diamond? Pretty good, huh?
Yeah. But just part of it. Only because my vulva is the size of a baseball right now. Or my uvula, not the vulva. The vulva's in the vagina. Thank you, Leo. I gotta head to work. Have a good stream, Mama. Love you. Thank you, Shadowy. Love the voice, but these aren't irony. These are examples of unfortunate events. Yeah. I don't think she knew the definition of irony, bless her heart. I'm famous by osmosis. Osmosis? I don't know what that means. I love you, Kwai.
All right, no four. That kind of sucks. It's a four-way pot. I think I kind of like setting up the barrel. So I'm going to bet the flop. Like, that's my biggest problem is the guy in the blind. Like, sometimes we're getting trapped, but kind of, you know, it's hard for somebody to flop trips. So this player usually just has one pair. I'm going to check the turn and bet the river. I mean, this guy's taking a long time. Should I just go bet, bet, bet? It's my problem is here. If I go bet, 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 then I have to bet way too big. I'm going to check and bet all rivers. I think, especially if this guy checks, I'm just going to bet all rivers. Okay. It's a big bluff. All right. Got past the real volatile one. Yeah. Bet, check, bet. How you like that? Some tempo in a three-way pot. I like that. I like that. I like that. Nice move. Nice move.
We can't raise.
I spun my way in. I did it. Look at that. Look at that. For $1.71, I'm in the 1650 30K. How you like me now? Hey, we're in the cash. I spun my way in. I spun my way into this thing. Red felt hype. I spun my way in for $1.71, and we have cashed so far for $33. Talk about an ROI.
All right, it's not the worst flop in the world. Kind of depends what this guy does. He's from the U.S., so I expect a C-bet on all flops. How about the queen or jack of spades? Queen of spades is pretty good. I'm going to check here. If he checks, I'm definitely going to bomb the river. And that might be a little bit too big, but I think it's okay. We're not getting him off a king. We're trying to get him off a queen. No fear. No fear. No fear.
No.
Holy shit, and he calls? Ace or king? No diamond. No diamond. At least no diamond. Oh, come on. Ace or king. Don't tell me I fucking bubble. You motherfucker. Oh, the bubble busted. Oh, we got paid. That's why he called, because the bubble busted. Son of a bitch. The bubble busted, and then he called. So we got paid. Son of a bitch. Pocket nines? You call off 80% of your stack with pocket nines before the bubble busted.
That's fucking awful. That's bad. Like, you never make that call. I mean, I'm obviously never folding to this guy if he jams. I mean, if he calls and this guy jams, it really sucks. Because that's what I would do with aces. Come on, bro. Like, you don't have enough chips to make me fold. You just don't. All right, snap call. Yeah, it doesn't matter what you have. Spades and jacks. I mean, good. Good. Hold. Good. That's what you deserve.
We've got to be able to get some kind of reading on that shield, up or down. Well, how could they be jamming us if they don't know if we're coming?
Tell your friends, kids, we got a final table. We got to run. Oh, that's rough. I do have to open it. Three betting here is kind of really strong. This is really strong because of this player's call. This is really strong. I mean, it's a good squeeze, but it also has to be something good. So, yeah! Good fold, good fold. Almost jammed it, but I had to think about it. With this big stack behind, man, how you like that fold now? Pocket eights, rewarded.
Take a face of action. Green food, stay across the holding sector of each other.
Admiral, we have enemy ships in sector 47.
It's a trap.
This player raises, this one calls. I'm going to go ahead and make the bad re-raise. I'm going to do it pretty quickly. We're basically playing this one like jokers. We're trying to get jammed on. This player can still reopen the betting, so we're going to be playing for a side pot versus this player quite a bit if this guy jams. I think it's fine. It's very risky. We're 25 off the cash. But aces, man. Aces, man. This guy should only be jamming. Yep. Rejam. Let's play for a side pot, bro. You got jacks or something? Let's do it. Sweet. Nines, that's interesting. Hold me, baby. Hold me, baby. Fuck you. What a goddamn fish. What an utter goddamn fish. Pocket nines.